joy to be worshiping with you today. I am pleased that we've been able to lift restrictions for worship, but that does not mean that you can't implement your own restrictions if that makes you feel safer and more at ease. Everyone has reasons for the choices that they make, and that should be respected. I've had one of my two vaccines, so I'm going to wear a mask half the time this morning. If you have not communed with us before using these little packets, let me take a moment to instruct you. You will be released by the ushers to one of the two tables. Please follow their instructions. This packet holds bread and juice. There's a clear cellophane wrapper on top. If you pull it back, there's a piece of white bread underneath it. Then once you remove the bread, there's a second cover to pull back, and the juice is underneath that. Then there's a trash receptacle by each table that you can drop it into. They're all non-alcoholic, and there are a few gluten-free wafers on the plates on each table. So, I understand that next Sunday we'll be celebrating the fact that I'm finally leaving. If you can find it, you can read all about that in your bulletin. It's a very subtle announcement, so good luck with that. As always, our announcements are posted on our website. FX3 is meeting today at 12:30 at the Hutchison Home. The address, forms, and information have been sent via email, but contact Kat if you have any questions. And now we will stand for the governor's song.
Christ is Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you breathe life into us, and your Spirit breathes truth into the world. Transform us by your truth, and give us words to proclaim your love to the world.
Amen.
The first reading is from Acts. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rush of violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven, living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and all parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They're filled with a new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, and that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams, even upon my slaves, both men and women. In those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoking mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Romans. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only in the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for the adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Truth, who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning, because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears. And he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But nowhere so dramatically as in the Gospels and the Acts of the Apostles. At the Last Supper of Jesus with his disciples, according to John, Jesus told the disciples that when he departed, he would send the Holy Spirit to guide them in the truth and to glorify Jesus. Just before Jesus ascended into heaven, according to Luke's gospel, he said to his disciples, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Luke began his sequel, titled Acts of the Apostles, writing, "In the first book, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. He ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father, when they would be baptized with the Holy Spirit in not many days." Throughout Jesus' ministry, the disciples understandably had a hard time comprehending a lot of the things Jesus said and did. He told them a number of times that he would suffer and be crucified and on the third day be raised from the dead. And yet they were surprised when it literally happened. I certainly don't fault them for that. They couldn't have understood what all that meant before it happened. There weren't any hopes of or visions about the Messiah in which he suffered and died. It was inconceivable that the Messiah would die without fulfilling any of the expectations. And how could anyone possibly understand resurrection when such a thing had never happened before? The resurrected Jesus had to appear to them and had to confirm his identity to them and had to explain things to them. Jesus showed them how all of the scripture pointed to him and to his suffering and death and resurrection. Jesus explained everything to them that had happened and told them to wait for the Holy Spirit to come, at which time they would take over his mission. He told them a number of times that the Holy Spirit was coming, but they could not have understood what that meant either before it happened. Well, what happened is what this day, the day of Pentecost, is all about. The Holy Spirit came suddenly with a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the whole house. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among the apostles, and a tongue rested on each of them, and all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. The crowd was bewildered and amazed and astonished because such a thing had never happened to them before either. Peter, who had recently denied even knowing Jesus and had hidden himself away, was suddenly a brave public preacher of the good news of God church didn't look much like church as we have experienced it, though. The believers formed communities where they pooled and shared all their resources. They worshiped in homes, and they particularly took care of the widows and orphans, and collected food for the hungry, and proclaimed the truth about Jesus Christ and sin and righteousness and judgment. The truth that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Over the last 2,000 years, the church has changed a lot as the world has changed. In our lifetimes, the church has changed a lot as the world has continued to change. In the last 2 years, the church, including Good Shepherd congregation, has changed. The church, including Good Shepherd congregation, is changing even now in ways we can't understand because we haven't experienced them yet. So what we really need to be focused on is proclaiming the truth about Jesus Christ and sin and righteousness and judgment. The truth that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And of course, we should also be concerned about taking care of widows and orphans and feeding the hungry. The Apostle Paul wrote some really important things about the church and the Holy Spirit that sound very contemporary. He said that creation is groaning. That's probably true now more than ever. He said that the faithful must continue with hope and patience. That's probably true now more than ever. He said that when we are weak, the Spirit will intercede for us. When we are faced with the misery of the world or futility, that the Holy Spirit prays on our behalf. And we should and could and can trust the Holy Spirit. From beginning to end, Scripture is filled with the work of the Holy Spirit. We know what the Spirit can do, but we do not know what the Spirit will do. Whatever it is, it will glorify God. Let us pray that the Holy Spirit will still guide the church, including Good Shepherd